Hello everyone, my name is Travis Pinto, Enterprise Sales Engineer here at Netskope, and today I'm going to be talking about the securing of non-sanctioned applications in your environment. So Netskope is very flexible as far as the different deployment options that we provide to our customers. There's offline and inline options. I'm going to be focusing on the inline options, specifically the forward proxy type deployments that consist of either parent proxy, explicit pack, DNS, or the steering client. These are all good options for securing those non-sanctioned applications. Before I jump into the policy goals, I need to explain the interface a little bit, and to do that, I'm inside of my tenant looking at the scope at events. These are all application events for an inline type deployment, and I'm going to be going over some of these events. And so with Netskope, it'll automatically create event records for all of the users accessing all of the managed applications. So if I go down the list here, you'll see my various users access applications and then do things inside of those applications. For example, here we see someone go to Gmail and upload a file, or someone send an email, or someone create a folder inside of Box. And so with the Netskope product, not only do we see users accessing applications, we can also see the activity, the variable, and the value. So what did the user do? What did they do it to? And then what was that actual value? These can all be taken into consideration from a policy standpoint, which we'll get into a little bit later. Okay. From here, I'm gonna move into this specific event that I've got opened up. You'll notice that there's some arrows on the left-hand side where I can get a little bit of additional detail into the event data. And I want to focus on two areas, the user area and the application area. Let's go ahead and start in the application area that you see right here. You'll see that the application is obviously Google or Gmail. But specifically, it says Broadway NS. Essentially, what's going on is with Netskope, it has the product has the ability to identify the unique instance ID of each one of the applications that the users go to. This is how we're able to identify your sanctioned Google Apps account versus someone's personal Gmail account, for instance. It works the same way with other types of applications like Box, Office 365, etc. Sometimes it comes in the form of a number, sometimes it's by name. It really just depends on the application, but in this example you can tell that I'm going to Gmail, specifically Google Apps for this specific account, my BroadwayNS.com account. From there we can also see two different users in the user area that accessed this application. This is the user that's logged into my machine. I can tell all the information about the machine, its IP address, the type of device, operating system, browser used, and then also down here is the from user. What account did they use to access that specific application? Because I can see that the user accessed my BroadwayNS Google Apps account and logged in with BroadwayNS.com account, I can kind of confirm that this is the sanctioned BroadwayNS application and not a personal use application of Google Mail. Now let's see what it looks like when a user accesses an application that would be like a personal use application. So here I've opened up some additional events where a user accessed Microsoft Live Outlook.com, and let's go over the application and user area one more time. So if we go into the application area, we'll get to see that the user went to Microsoft Live Outlook.com. This is the free version of essentially Office 365 email. If we move a little bit farther down, that you'll notice it went straight to the category and no instance ID. Oftentimes, when a user's accessing a non-sanctioned application or a free type application, they won't have an instance ID, or the instance ID will be like a zero or something like that. And so this is an easy way to tell that this is a free version or non-instance ID application. So this would essentially be a personal use application. Another thing that I can see is when the user logged into the specific application, they did not use that BroadwayNS account ID. From here, if I move to the right, I'm still able to capture the same activity, variable, and value information, where I can see where the user created some specific folders, uploaded a file, and sent an email. But we can tell the difference between the users accessing those sanctioned applications and then users accessing the non-sanctioned applications like the Microsoft Live Outlook.com. The instance IDs can be used in policies. This is how I'm able to explicitly allow my Google Apps instance of Broadway NS, or even allow, say, a partner's instance of Box. And so we identify each of those instance IDs, and here are some of the identified instance IDs for my specific tenant. This is also going to allow me to treat the instance ID separate from the personal use applications like what you see right here. So now we know how Netskope can see applications from an inline perspective, where we can see things like the variable, the instance ID, the activity performed inside of the application. Let's take that knowledge and apply it to securing the applications, whether it's the sanctioned application or the non-sanctioned application. Here's a model that'll help you, as well as most other companies, secure. For instance, this case, we'll be talking about cloud storage. And in this example, the sanctioned application is going to be Box. The same example can apply to any type of application or application category. Starting from the bottom, I'm going to work my way up. We're going to have our sanctioned application down here at the bottom. And then as we move up the list, these top three will apply essentially to the non-sanctioned cloud storage applications that are out there. To talk about it, we're going to have a couple different policy levels, and I'm going to go through each one of those right now. The starting point is typically right here. You have your sanctioned application, and the majority of your users should have access to that sanctioned application. Of course, we can do that because we can see your sanctioned application's instance ID and just make sure that that's explicitly allowed for the majority of your users. I know that in some cases, maybe some users don't have access to it, but I'm just saying for most companies, their users have access to the sanctioned applications. From there, we move into three different policy levels for the non-sanctioned applications. Starting here, the next level up, something called a no-access user. You may want to call it something different, but essentially there's going to be certain folks out there that just do not need access to non-sanctioned cloud storage, and that's okay. And then also, you may not want to allow some of your users to non-sanctioned cloud storage with an extremely low cloud confidence index rating. Or maybe you don't want them, you know, uploading stuff to cloud storage outside of the United States or something along those lines. The no-access user is very secure. So if a user can't go to non-sanctioned cloud storage, you don't have to worry about data leakage. The problem with this right here is it's very poor for collaborating. For instance, let's say that your sanctioned application is Box, and one of your users is doing business with Travis Pinto over at Netskope, and I use Google Drive, and I need to send one of these no-access users a link to download some content. They're not going to be able to because you're blocking the non-sanctioned cloud storage. So very good from a security perspective, not so good from a collaboration perspective. That's where these two layers come into play. This is the next one up. I call it the limited access user. This is where we allow the users to go to the non-sanctioned cloud storage applications, but what we do is we block the risky activities. So what are the risky activities that can be performed in an application like cloud storage or webmail or collaboration tools, things like that? Here are some examples. Upload, post, share, and send are typical, you know, activities where data can potentially leak out. So with Netskope, what you can do is create a limited access user policy that allows users to go to the non-sanctioned cloud storage, but limit the user's ability to perform those actions. Upload, post, share, and send. So if a user is not able to perform these specific activities, you can secure those applications while still allowing them to collaborate. For instance, users that get the limited access profile can receive my Google Drive link. They can view it, they can download the content, but they're not able to upload or share once they're inside of any, you know, Google App application or other types of cloud storage applications. So this is really powerful and in a nice way to secure some of those applications that you may be just straight up blocking today. From there, you will have the privileged access user. This is going to be the user that's allowed to go to the non-sanctioned cloud storage applications and then perform all of the activities inside of that application. So, you know, it can range anywhere from like 6 to 14 different activities that you can perform in a given application. The riskier of those being upload, post, share, send, and there's some others. But if you do have a privileged access user that is allowed to go to, say, the non-sanctioned cloud storage and perform all of these riskier activities, now would be a good time to use Netskope's advanced DLP to secure the content. For instance, they can go to the non-sanctioned cloud storage, they can upload, post, share, and send, which are the riskier activities, but we can use data loss prevention type policies to prevent or coach users away from uploading things that may contain PHI data, PII data, PCI data, or intellectual property. So this is a good model that should work for the majority of customers out there. Again, there's going to be, you know, depending on the company, there'll be little things that may need to be changed, and some of these different access levels will vary depending on the company, but this is a good model for best practices for securing cloud storage applications and other applications. Again, it's not specific to cloud storage, it's just an example. This could apply to any application or application category. So again, this is Travis Pinto, and I want to thank you for taking the time to watch this video, and I hope that you found it useful.